You've been asked to add an audit log to your application, which basically documents all changes someone performed on the data. You need to collect and store all the required information in a simple and error-proof way, and that's much harder than it might seem in the beginning. In this video, I will very quickly explain what an audit log is, which information it usually contains, and the challenges it creates when implementing it. After that, I will put on my consultant hat to summarize the different types of implementations I've seen in projects and explain why you should avoid the most obvious implementation. Okay, so what is an audit log? If you ask Wikipedia, you get this definition. The short version is that an audit log keeps track of all the actions performed on the data being audited. In the context of a relational database, this log is usually stored in a separate set of database tables that maintain a copy of every version of each audited database record. So whenever you insert a new record, update an existing one, or delete one, your application writes a copy of that record to a separate database table. But if you modify a record multiple times within the same transaction, the audit log usually only stores the final version. This also includes records in relationship tables, which, for example, represents a many-to-many relationship, and that's something many teams forget in their first implementation. Changes to the relationship between audited records should also be audited. If you want, you can also include more information than just the changes in your audit log. Audit logs often also include timestamps and users who performed the change. This information is often required and makes your audit log much more useful in general. And before you ask, you can also include read operations, but I strongly suggest not doing so unless you really have to. Auditing read operations can drastically slow down your application. So if you don't have to include read operations, only audit write operations. That's also what most audit log libraries do. Now that you know what an audit log is, the next question is, how do you implement it? As so often, there are many different ways to do that. The most obvious one is letting your business logic write the audit log. I mean, it already modifies the data, so why not let it write the audit entries as well? Every time you persist, change, or remove a record, you also write the record's new state to the audit table. Sounds easy? But it isn't. Using this approach, you have to implement everything yourself, and I highly recommend not doing that. It introduces a high risk of missing a few places in your code where you would need to write the audit log. And if you're using Hibernate or any other object relational mapping framework, this gets even worse because the framework handles the update statements. So you're no longer in control, and matching the audit records with the actual update operations gets even harder. Another and much more reliable approach is to define a set of database triggers that write your audit log. Depending on your configuration, the database automatically executes them for every insert, update, or delete operation on a specific table. This has the huge benefit that you don't have to worry about the audit log in your business code, and you will not miss anything. If you have a DBA on your team, they will most likely be a huge fan of such an implementation, at least until they recognize they are the best qualified to implement those triggers. And that implementation can be tricky if a transaction modifies the same record multiple times. That often happens in modular applications where different modules work within the same transaction on the same data. Or if you're using an object relational mapping framework like Hibernate or any other JPA implementation. In that case, your trigger has to check if it has already written an audit entry for that record during the current transaction and modify it. To make it even worse, the implementation of such triggers is database specific. That means if your application has to support different databases, you must implement a custom set of triggers for each of them. As you see, you can implement an audit log using database triggers, and that's better than having your business logic write the audit log. But I only recommend doing that if you have a team of DBAs who have the experience and time to write and maintain those triggers. Here on YouTube, I'm mostly talking about Hibernate and Spring Data JPA. So I guess you are a Java developer familiar with those frameworks and not a DBA. Instead of implementing database triggers, you probably prefer writing some Java code, and you might have heard about lifecycle listeners. Hibernate can call them automatically whenever you persist, update, or remove an entity. So they seem like an obvious solution to the problems I described earlier, right? Well, they are to some extent. If you register your listener correctly, it will automatically get called whenever an entity gets modified, and Hibernate handles the different database dialects for you. But there are two problems. Based on the Jakarta persistence specification and the Hibernate documentation, a listener is only allowed to modify the entity object for which it was triggered. So you're not officially allowed to write a record to your audit log. And you already know the second problem from the database trigger. If you trigger multiple write operations for the same entity, your listener gets called multiple times, and you have to ensure to overwrite the audit record you previously wrote within your current transaction. You can, of course, solve both problems. However, the more popular and much easier option is using Hibernate Envers for your audit log. Internally, Hibernate Envers uses lifecycle listeners to integrate with Hibernate ORM and automatically write the audit log. You might now expect it to run into the same issues we discussed earlier, but the important difference is that the same team develops Hibernate ORM and Hibernate Envers. So they know exactly how to solve those problems and can ensure that their solution works with every new Hibernate version, even if it might not be 100% compliant with the specification. Based on my experience, Hibernate Envers is the best solution for most projects that already use Hibernate ORM or Spring Data JPA. And it's so popular that I have recorded an entire course about it for the Persistence Hub. Instead of developing the audit log from scratch, you simply let Hibernate Envers manage your audit log for you. You only have to add a dependency to your project and annotate every entity class you want to include in your audit log with one simple annotation. Based on that, Hibernate Envers writes your audit log automatically. It also provides a query API and many customization options if you need them. That not only simplifies your first implementation and makes it easy to add Hibernate Envers to an existing project, but also ensures you're prepared for future requirement changes. In the next video, I will show you how to add Hibernate Envers and set up your audit log. So, see you there.